Greetings. Thank you, brother, for your interesting questions. Why should someone else suffer for our sins? Why can't God forgive our sins? And in many places, God will forgive sins if you confess. You've asked some very complicated questions, brother, and they deserve full and understandable answers. Let's go through these questions one by one, because each deserves an answer. Why should someone else suffer for our sins? You are asking about suffering for, which is synonymous with paying for, their sins. So as I address this question, I am going to use the two interchangeably. Suffering for sins, paying for sins. Let's take a moment and really understand what you are asking. Why should someone else suffer for your sins? Our sins. Your basic question is, why should? The text that follows the question could be anything. For example, why should you wear your seatbelt? To provide protection in a crash? Because it feels like a hug. Because the law requires it. Asking a question with the form, why should, is asking for a known reason. A rationale, a purpose. There are some questions we are curious about that we cannot ascribe a reason to. Why should the Earth be the third planet orbiting our sun? Why should a ball thrown into the air return to Earth? Why should a rainbow appear after a rain? Such questions assume intent and mind as the source of a purpose that can be explained. This is easy to see with human inventions created for a purpose. Why should cars have a seatbelt? To hold you in place in the event of a collision. Why should cars have brakes? To provide a way to slow the vehicle when desired. Asking such why should questions are very useful to gathering information about things that are intentionally designed. In some contexts, however, such questions are meaningless and unfruitful. Why should an airplane crash in a snowstorm? Why should a child die of a sickness or cancer? Why should people kill one another over a prophet's son? Why should someone else suffer for our sins? You asked a question that is framed in such a way to be rendered not very useful. But let's attempt to reframe it to get at the real heart of the question. Why should someone else suffer for our sins? We've discussed why should. It assumes a reason, a purpose, an intent, a plan. Depending on what follows, there may not be a reason, a purpose, an intent, a plan. Why should someone else suffer for our sins? Using the word someone makes this general, applying in all cases. This question is broadly seeking a reason in every case. You can filter the statement using a narrower noun, such as specifying a group. Why should some men suffer for our sins? This narrows the group to only men and excludes females. You can filter the statement to a single nationality. Why should some Jewish man suffer for our sins? You can filter the statement further to a single individual. Why should a Jewish man named Jesus suffer for our sins? For all these questions, these narrower and narrower contexts, the answer will be slightly different. So it is critical for you to understand what the purpose of the question is, what you are hoping to learn or accomplish. Why should someone else suffer for our sins? Framed this way, this wrongly assumes a universal concept that God randomly punishes innocent people for the sins of others. This question is based on misinformation and misunderstanding of the prophets of Jehovah God. it might be chosen as an attack on the concept of the gospel. And if one were intent on rejecting the Christian message, this is how to frame the question for students, to poison their thinking. Why should the Jewish man named Jesus suffer for our sins? Framed this way, this actually asks for information about the Judeo-Christian Messiah, as described by the prophets of Jehovah God. If one were actually an open-minded person, seeking an accurate representation of Christianity's gospel, this question would be more appropriate. Why should someone else suffer for our sins? Rather than answer the question poisoned by an erroneous assumption, I must dismiss it as just that. It is intentionally ill-formed and not designed for honest gathering of knowledge and understanding. Why should the Jewish man named Jesus suffer for our sins? This is the question I will answer because it is a legitimate question about the doctrines of Christianity and the message of the prophets. Nowhere in Christianity I am aware of is the concept taught that any Christian may suffer for the sins of another Christian. Such is as dumb and as wrong as Sam Harris claiming Christianity is a cult of human sacrifice. Why should the Jewish man named Jesus suffer for our sins? The shortest possible answer is that this act was the plan of God. Allow me to outline the plan of God revealed by the prophets and then supply the scriptural support. God existed before creation. God knew the future. God knew man would sin. God required a sacrifice for sin. God knew man could not pay for his own sins. God planned to provide a sacrifice. The Messiah was the planned sacrifice. Jesus was the Messiah. Therefore, Jesus was the planned sacrifice. Jesus was sacrificed once for all. Jesus volunteered. Jesus knew the choice was hard. Let's support this outline with some scriptures, because God's word must be the foundation. God existed before creation. John 17:5. This is Jesus praying, "And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed." Jesus existed with God before creation and knew he had existed with God before creation. Revelation 13:8. "And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb, slain from the foundation of the world." From the foundation or beginning of the world, meaning creation, Jesus was accounted as the Lamb, slain. He had to exist for that to happen. God knew the future. Acts 2:23. "He was delivered up by God's set plan and foreknowledge, and you, by the hands of the lawless, put him to death by nailing him to the cross." Isaiah 37:26. "Have you not heard? Long ago I ordained it. In days of old I planned it. Now I have brought it to pass, that you should crush fortified cities into piles of rubble." This is a specific example of God planning future events, therefore knowing them. Acts 3:18. "But in this way, God has fulfilled what he foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Christ would suffer." 1 Peter 1:20. "He was known before the foundation of the world, but was revealed in the last times for your sake." God knew man would sin. 1 John 3:20. "For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything." Psalm 147:5. "Great is the Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. Job 37:16. Do you know the balancings of the clouds? The wondrous works of him who is perfect in knowledge? Isaiah 46:10. Declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will accomplish all my purpose. Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. God knew that in advance. God required a sacrifice for sin. Leviticus 5:11. But if he cannot afford 2 turtle doves or 2 young pigeons, he may bring 1/10 of an ephah of fine flour as an offering for his sin. He must not put olive oil or frankincense on it, because it is a sin offering, an offering for sin. Leviticus 17:11. For the life of a creature is in the blood, and I have given it to you to make an atonement for your souls upon the altar, since it is the lifeblood that makes atonement. The clear implication is that God designed blood specifically to be used in sacrifice for sin, to make atonement. Hebrews 9:22. According to the law, in fact, nearly everything must be purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. God knew man could not pay for his own sins. Isaiah 64:6. But we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. And we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away. Our efforts at righteousness are as good as filthy rags. God planned to provide a sacrifice. Genesis 22:8. And Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went, both of them together. The Messiah was the planned sacrifice. Daniel 9:26a. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. Isaiah 53:8. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and who can recount his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. He was stricken for the transgression of my people. 1 Peter 1:19. But with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without spot or blemish. Jesus was the Messiah. Micah 5:2. But you, O Bethlehem Ephratah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. John 4:25-26. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. John 8:24. That is why I told you that you would die in your sins. For unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. Now, to be completely accurate, this is referring to Jesus being the Son of Man, who other scripture can easily establish is the Messiah. So Jesus said, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing on my own, but speak exactly what the Father has taught me. John 9:35. When Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, he found the man and said, do you believe in the Son of Man? Who is he, sir? He replied. Tell me so that I may believe in him. You have already seen him, Jesus answered. He is the one speaking with you. Jesus was the planned sacrifice. Acts 3:18. But in this way, God has fulfilled what he foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Christ, the Messiah, would suffer. Isaiah 53:7. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. John 1:29. The next day he, John, saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world." John 1:35. The next day John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus walking by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." Matthew 1:21. She, Mary, will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Jesus was sacrificed once for all. Hebrews 9:12. He did not enter by the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, thus securing eternal redemption. Luke 22:20. In the same way, after supper, he, Jesus, took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Luke 1:68. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has visited and redeemed his people. Hebrews 9:15. Therefore Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance. Now that he has died to redeem them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant, Jesus volunteered. Luke 22:42. Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. John 18:11. Put your sword back in its sheath, Jesus said to Peter. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me? Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus knew the choice was hard. Luke 22:42. Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. And in his anguish he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like drops of blood falling to the ground. Why should the Jewish man named Jesus suffer for our sins? Because Jesus was the Messiah, the planned Redeemer that God promised and foretold by the prophets to save all who will believe, thus fulfilling God's promise to Abraham that all nations would be blessed through Abraham. Genesis 18:18. Abraham will surely become a great and powerful nation, and through him all the nations of the earth will be blessed. I think hearing and understanding the plan of God revealed by the prophets of God answers all the important questions that are common to the minds of men. I hope you now understand the Christian teaching, based on the prophets, why the Jewish man Jesus voluntarily sacrificed himself for your sins. I'll get to your second question in the next part of this series. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.